risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
There is one body and one spirit.
There is one hope in God's call to us.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One God and Father of all.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
Loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us your kingdom. Bring us serving with God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Put your finger here and see my hand. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. my Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these were written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. I said to Peter, Peter, I owe you a favor for coming in and doing this. And it's kind of that line that we all hear when you don't mean something and you say to somebody, oh, we'll get together for lunch. Well, you have no interest in going to have lunch with somebody. But you still say it because that's the polite thing to say, well, let's go together. So I didn't intend at all for Peter to take me up on it. And as you well know, Peter, as the rector of your church, if you give him an inch, he'll take a mile. And before I had ever stopped saying, I owe you a favor, he said, you know, Patty and I don't want to preach the Sunday after Easter, so why don't you come and preach the Sunday after Easter? And so that's the reason why I'm here. Glad to be with you on top of that. But let's get on to the baptism to take place. So there'll be some jittery people sitting in the pews today, and I'll get going with the sermon for this morning. It's a story that normally associated people call it the Doubting Thomas story, but it's really, I don't think it's about a Doubting Thomas. It's about Thomas who rises to faith. But I'll get there in just a second. When I was in high school, I attended a high school in Rome, Georgia. Rome, Georgia is between Atlanta and Chattanooga, Tennessee. And the school was Berry Academy. It was a boarding school for boys. And the guy who was the head of the religion department at this school was an evangelical Baptist, Mr. Geraldson was the man's name. And so whenever he could sneak in an evangelical tied into the service, the services that we had there at the chapel, he would do so. And I'll never forget one guy who came in who was a real hardcore evangelical preacher of the kind that you only run into in the southeastern part of this country, who, you know, back in those days, this is the 1960s, he had his hair slicked back like this. Some of you are of my age, so you'll remember Brill Cream, and you remember the commercial that went, Brill Cream, a little dabble, do you? Well, this guy had really dabbed his hair with all this stuff like this, and he had a pompadour going on like this, you know, and he was sitting there, and he would get up there in that pulpit, in that chapel, and he would start going on about, you need to be saved, to the Eastern High School student, boy high school students from the 9th to 12th grade, you need to be saved, and if you come forward, you're going to be saved, you need to be saved, you need to be saved, you need to be saved. Well, you know, I went up front because I thought that if I don't go up front, this man's going to die right in front of us. Little did I know that it was really my life dependent on it. But we had a bunch of us went up there, but he would stand up there and he'd say, won't you come forward? And he looked at you and he said, won't you come forward? And he looked at everyone, won't you come forward? And won't you come forward? And won't you come forward? And he kept going on like this. I thought, well, he was going to die. And then some of us finally went up there just because we wanted to stop. One of my professors at Virginia Theological Seminary was a man named Murray Newman. And Murray Newman attended Union Theological Seminary in New York City, which in the time that he attended, it was the seminary in the United States.
At that time, theologians like Reinhold Niebuhr were teaching there, Paul Tillich was teaching there, and then there was another professor that not as well known as our student neighbor, Rudolf Bultmann, was teaching there. And Rudolf Bultmann wrote a book entitled The Theology of the New Testament. And what he wanted to do was to demythologize the New Testament so that smart people of the middle of the 20th century would be people who would be able to believe, who would be able to understand the gospel, who would be able to come forward. So he would stand up there, and Murray used to tell the story, that he would stand up there at the pulpit of Union Theological Seminary, and he would say, you know, I'm telling you, I'm demythologizing these stories, I'm making them accessible to you, because you are smart people in the United States. You are you have the brains that you need to understand these stories, the sensible stories. And he said, I'm demystifying all of these stories so that you, the brilliant students at Union Theological Seminary, can be people of faith. And Murray said that he would stand up there and finally everybody just say, we get it. Our gospel writer today fits along those lines. He's telling a story about rising to faith. And he tells us a story of Thomas. Remember Thomas? He appears twice before. Thomas appears one time, and he's the one who, when Jesus says they're going to go to Bethany, he's the one who says, we'll go with you and die with you there. Because it was almost a suicide mission. And he's the one who says, we'll go with you and we'll die with you there. And he's also the one that when Jesus says, you know the way, he's the one who says, how do we know the way? How can we find the way? And Jesus responds to him. And he appears now in our particular story. You just heard it read, so we don't need to review too much of it. But Jesus appears to the disciples that are gathered in that upper room, and he says to them when he comes through to see them, he says, peace be with you, which I tell you is a very generous comment to say to people who have left him alone, who left him at the moment of his crucifixion. And he says, peace be with you. And then he goes on and greets them. The resurrection of Christ, one of the appearances of the Christ. Thomas, of course, wasn't there. He was missing. He must have been out shopping or doing something like that, getting the groceries for the rest of the group for the next week. So when he finally comes back, the other disciples say to him, you know what? We saw the resurrected Christ. We believe because we saw the resurrected Christ. And he said, well, I didn't get to see the resurrected Christ. I'm not going to believe. Until I get to touch the resurrected Christ, I'm not going to believe in anything. So sure enough, Jesus shows up again, and he says to him, put your hands here on my side. Feel the wounds. And what's interesting about the story is that Thomas never puts his hands on his side. And he's the first one in the Gospel of John, here at the very end of the Gospel, who says, my Lord and my God. He is the first one. The one that we call Doubting Thomas is the first one in the Gospel of John who rises to faith. I don't think the story is a resurrection story. I think the story is about someone who rises to faith. And John's Gospel, as you read the passage today, go back and read it somewhere along the line. In that passage he says, you know, I've been telling you all these stories all this time. I've written all these chapters. I've kept all these stories. There were other stories to write down. There were other things to talk about. There were other things that I could have written here. But I wrote these stories so that you, the listener, you, the reader, you who sit here at St. Margaret's Church can rise to faith. So that you too can rise to faith. One of the things I love about Thomas, I think Thomas is my cousin. Because I think with all my heart that for faith to be faith, it has to have an element of doubt. If faith has proof, then it's not faith, it's something else. But faith to be faith has to have an element of doubt, an element of uncertainty, which quite frankly is what then can keep any of us from going on some sort of personal crusade about somebody against somebody else who has a different version of the faith. And it allows us to question someone, to be engaging with somebody, to be in conversation with somebody without accusing them that they have it wrong. I tell you, I'm a Christian because this is where I see the light shining the brightest. I'm drawn to the light because this is where I see the light shining the brightest. But I want to tell you something else. Other people see the light shining brightly somewhere else. My task is to believe where I see the light shining the brightest, to be drawn to that light, and to let that light shine as brightly as possible within my own life so that other people may be drawn to it. But I would never, ever be able to confront someone and say, I have faith, and because you don't agree with me, you don't have faith. One of the great things at the baptism service is that in a little while you're going to be asked to reaffirm your faith. Do you believe in God the Father? Do you believe in the Christ? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? And I would invite you that your responses can be couched in doubt. I used to tell to the people at St. John's Church that every Easter Sunday morning, I would say to them, you know, first of all, welcome. The second thing I would say to them, you know, I don't care why you are here, but I think that God will be very pleased for you to believe in as much as God as you can, and that's fine. Because it is honest. And I think when we respond, do you believe in God the Father? Yes, as much as I can, and that's the Creator. Do you believe in Jesus as the Christ? Yes, I believe Jesus as the Christ as much as I can, and that's the best that I can do. And the same thing with the Holy Spirit. We're all on a journey of faith, and this is the beginning of journey of faith, the journey of faith for all those who are going to be baptized. And we continue to reaffirm that every Sunday that we have baptism when those questions are asked. Do you believe in God the Father? Do you believe in God, Jesus, Son of God? Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? Those are the critical questions today. When I was an assistant at St. Peter's Church in Charlotte, North Carolina, I met with a group of assistant clergy. I was an assistant clergy straight out of seminary. And we would meet on a weekly or every month basis or something like that. And there was a Baptist in there and a Presbyterian and a Methodist and so on and so forth. And these were all very evangelical types. Charlotte was in the middle of the Bible Belt also. And they were always really laying into me. You know, clergy are not competitive. Clergy are not competitive. But they would always lay in on me. You know, the problem with you Episcopalians is this. Is that you don't ever have a revival in your churches. They say, you guys have got it all wrong. You never have a revival. You never give people the opportunity to be able to come forward and dedicate themselves in a sense to, you know, come forward. Won't you come forward? Won't you come forward? It took me a long time to think about it. And then I finally got it. You know, and I said, not that we're competitive, but I said, well, the problem is that you guys don't do it frequently enough. We do it every Sunday morning. And it may not be called hitting the sawdust trail, but here at St. Margaret's, it's called hitting the red carpet trail. For all of you, get out of your pews and you come forward to the altar, to some extent or another, to say, my Lord and my God. In whichever form you can say it, and as best as you can, every Sunday morning, we say, my Lord and my God, by hitting the red carpet trail. They never had anything to come back on that one. My old friend, that preacher at Berry Academy, won't you come forward? Won't you come forward? Rudolf Boltman did the same thing for those bright people at Union Theological Seminary. Won't you come forward? Won't you come forward? John the Baptist is doing the same thing. John the Gospeler is doing the very same thing today. I'm telling you all these stories, not so that you can have facts, not so that you can have proof, but so that you can rise to faith. And so that you too, with Thomas, may be able to say, my Lord and my God.
baptism will now be presented. Responsible for seeing that the child you present is brought up in the Christian faith and life? Will you, by your prayers and witness, help these children to grow into the full stature of Christ? Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God? You renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God?
I renounce them.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior?
I do.
Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love?
I do.
Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord?
I do.
A question for all of you present today. Will all of you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ?
No.
Please stand as you are able. Let us join with those who are committing themselves to Christ by renewing our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered and
through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin to everlasting life. Thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it we are buried with Christ in his death. By it we share in his resurrection. Through it we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who here are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ, our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Baptism and marked as Christ's own forever.
Amen. Amen.
Name this child.
Oh,
you have bestowed upon these, your servants, the forgiveness of sin, and have raised them to the new life of grace. Sustain them, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give them an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage to do your will and persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works.
Amen.
Let us welcome the newly baptized.
We receive you in the gospel of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified. Proclaim his resurrection. And share with us in his eternal kingdom.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Servers and our chalice bearers and our acolytes. You warm my heart. You just warm my heart and explode it, because what you give to this church makes us who we are. So thank you. And now ascribe to the Lord the honor due God's name, bring offerings, and come into God's courts.
Proclaim the glory of your name.
prophets, and above all in the Word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presented to you from your creation, this bread and this wine. We pray, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable to him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, Margaret, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say it together.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.